Very good morning and welcome all. Thank you. Option trading strategies. Today we have with us Mr. Vineet Singh Kaler, Senior Manager, Training and Education with Multi Commodity Exchange of India Limited, and Mr. Steven D'Souza, who is a part of business team of MCX. Mr. Vineet Singh Kaler is a postgraduate in planning and entrepreneurship with specialization in finance and marketing, with over 14 years of experience in financial market, treasury operations, risk management, and exchange industry. So MCX is India's first listed exchange that facilitates online trading of commodity derivatives transactions, thereby providing a platform for price discovery and risk management. The exchange started its operation in November 2003, operates under the regulatory framework of Securities and Exchange Board of India, that is SEBI. So I welcome both of you, and I request Mr. Vineet Singh to take this forward.
Thank you, ma'am, for the introduction. I would like to greet all of you. Good morning. Welcome to the session on commodity options, and primarily options and option strategies in general. So what I'm trying to do now is, this is the live market screen running in front of you. This is right now derivatives on futures. I'm just trying to show you the options, you know, which options, how that looks on the live screen, and then we'll move on to the concepts. See, before I add option contracts here, just to tell you, just follow the cursor. With the first column is futures, which says instruments. It is futures on commodities. So since we'll be talking about options, so I just wanted to tell you, when we talk about options, we have right now two kinds of options. One is options on futures, wherein future contract becomes the underlying for the option contract. This is a derivative market, complete derivative market. So we have options on futures. Okay, so it means that if I have a gold option on future, the underlying becomes a gold future contract. So that is what I'm trying to show you. I mean, just see, I'm just trying to put in the close prices now. Since we talk about options, this is a very important thing. We'll definitely talk about this in the presentation, but I would like to tell you here itself. Could you see this drop down? When we talk about options and option trading, we talk about strike prices. Can you see, in this drop down, there are many strike prices. There are prices given, different kinds of prices are given. Now, these prices are called as strike prices. Whereas in the futures screen, which is already running, there is nothing called as strike prices. So people who deal in future, they deal in the actual price there and then. People who trade in options, what they trade in is the premium which they buy and sell, the premium amount for all the strike levels which are available. So if I would say, we have a few options on futures wherein underlying is a future contract. So if the underlying price in front of you, it's say, for example, the first row on the screen is the future on gold, which is running at say 44,800 levels. Okay, now in this, if I want to be near the market price, okay, so I can choose any kind of price on which I can trade. And when I choose any kind of price from these strike intervals, it is where I will be able to see the premiums to deal on those prices. So I'm just taking this 44,800 as the strike price, and I just did enter. Okay. You know what, there are different strike levels. Maybe on the strike levels, nobody is giving the premium to trade as of now, because it's the there are different prices which are there available. 44,845 is something which is there. So let me just change this to maybe 900. So at different levels you can put in. See what has happened, it comes the options on futures. Okay, now when we talk about options, there are two kinds of options. One is the call option, and the other is the put option. I'm just trying to show, you know, different kinds here. Could you make a difference from here? It is CANPA. Now, what does this mean? CANPA, it means on a given strike level, the call premiums and put premiums will differ. Okay, this is what I'm trying to introduce here. Now, these are called as option on future. You could see the screen on the left side, it's option on future. The other kinds of option contracts which are there on the exchange, I've just taken one example. The other would be option in commodity. Like we have futures on commodity, the underlying is a physical product. Here we have the option on commodity, which means the underlying again becomes the physical product, and you can choose different strike prices and levels on which you could trade. So my motto of showing you the live screen right now is, you know, to just give you a difference between them. It is option on future, this is option on commodity. So what I'm trying to do now is I'm just trying to move away from the live screen. We can anyways come back to the live screen, and I'm coming to the presentation for today. The topic for discussion is about options. So we have kept all about options. When you talk about this kind of a market platform, which is a commodity segment, we have options on futures on five products, that is gold, crude, copper, silver and zinc, and options on the actual underlying product as a commodity is available in the gold mini options. But nevertheless, if you learn about options, whatever platform is there, if you know about options, know about option strategies, you can trade in any segments. The only difference is the underlying will change, and the dynamics on those underlying is what you have to understand. Okay, so the agenda of today's presentation will be, we'll talk about option basics, then we'll talk about, touch about something called as option Greeks, then we'll talk about the contracts available, which we have just seen on the live market contracts available, you know, how do they look, or what are the features like option on futures and option on goods, their settlement, devolvement, and then we'll talk about option strategies. So this is the flow. Before I start my presentation on options, I would like to reemphasize on the fact that when we are in an option market, futures market, these are all derivatives. So derivatives are nothing but financial instruments. So in the financial markets, we have primarily capital market, debt market, forex, commodity and money market. So the commodity market, which is highlighted in red, is the segment in which you will have commodity futures and options on the exchange platform, which is live, wherein people come and mitigate their risk and discover the prices of the product. So when we talk about commodity market, financial instruments, futures and options, their valuations. So the valuations or the prices of these commodity products get impacted by other asset classes as well. So that is why, you know, financial markets, they are all integrated. So this is where, you know, portfolio managers, hedge funds, investors, they are easily able to see the relation between these asset segments, and they are able to park their money in these segments in terms of strategies made out of options and futures, or combined in or it would be totally options, it would be totally futures, or combined futures and options. So a lot of strategies could be done. When we talk about commodities, definitely commodities fundamentals play a very important role in determining what could be the price of the product. And basis on those prices, futures and options are traded, because futures and options are instrument whose underlying is the physical product. Plus, apart from the own commodity fundamentals, demand, supply, consumption, import, export, availability of product, government policies, geopolitical scenarios, so many of them are there attributed to commodities. Apart from their own fundamentals, they also get impacted from the currency prices, currency price movement, that is the dollar rate compared to other currencies, which is a currency pair, plus interest rates, which comes from the debt market, also have an impact on the currency as well as commodity segment. as well as from the capital market. So when we talk about commodity market, we have to also understand what other asset classes are having an impact, in what range, what is the actual real impact of maybe change in currency value or interest rates or the equity market on the commodity asset class as well. So overall, in commodity segment, we have four main sub segments, which is agri segment, base metals, energy and bullion. All across the world, we have around 86 commodity exchanges wherein you will find all these futures and option contracts being traded. So these all segments are also available on MCX as well, wherein you have derivatives, futures and options. So let us just start with the main theme of today, which is the options. So what is an option? An option is a contract. It is a financial instrument that gives the buyer, that is the buyer of the option, right to buy or sell, but no obligation. It means the contract gives the buyer right, but no obligation to buy or sell the underlying asset at a specific price, which would be a strike price on or before a certain date. Okay. So the highlighting points are, it always gives, when you deal in options as a buyer, you always get a right. Okay. Now, since we are on the exchange platform and since we are talking about options, let me just mention upfront, options are the only instruments which are traded both in OTC as well as exchange traded segments. Now, when I say OTC, OTC means one-to-one trading and one-to-one negotiable contract. So options could be done both on OTC as well as, this is the only derivative which is present both in OTC as well as the exchange traded market. So now, what do we mean by the buyer always gets the right but no obligation? If you are familiar with the futures contract, what happens in a future contract, if you take a position on the exchange, then both buyers and sellers, if you are a buyer of a derivative contract, then there will be also a seller of the same derivative contract. So both buyer and seller, they are obligated to buy or sell till the time they exit the positions or till the time the contract comes to an expiry. It means both the buyers and seller needs to make the premium margin payment, okay, to the exchange using futures. And they are obligated to exit the positions and then square up. They are obligated. Both buyers and sellers are obligated. But when we are with the options contract, the buyer gets the right, buyer of the options, the seller gets the obligation. So this is something, you know, which is, I would say, a kind of privilege a person gets over other. So it is a right which one person gets. So to give a right to somebody, it requires an extra payment. Now, this extra payment is nothing but called as a premium which buyer pays to get this right. So before I go further, let me just take a small example. We all know what insurance is, and definitely we all have different insurance policies against our names. So I'm sure many of us or all of us are aware what a mediclaim insurance is. Just to give you an example, what an option contract is. In mediclaim insurance, what you do is you insure yourself for a year by paying a premium amount. Say, for example, you have paid 20,000 rupees as a premium amount against all kinds of illnesses for a year. Now, by paying premium, what do you get is a assurance that, you know, in case you fall ill and you are admitted in a hospital for any covered diseases which are there in the policy, you will be covered till the extent of the policy amount. And the sum assured was, say, 5 lakhs. Okay, you pay 20,000 as a premium money upfront for a 5 lakh cover for any illnesses or hospitalization which would happen. Now, by paying that premium of 20,000, you get a right to demand money from the insurance company in case you fall ill and are admitted. So whatever expenses you incur for the illness to be cured, at the end, whatever the bill is, you are having the right to claim that amount from the insurance company till the maximum amount of 5 lakh of rupees, which was a sum assured. Okay, so to get that right to claim up till 5 lakh of rupees for the illnesses which are covered in case of hospitalization, you get the right by paying 20,000 rupees as premium. Okay, now understand, you are a buyer of insurance policy, insurance company is the seller of insurance policy. As a buyer, you get the right to claim till the 5 lakh or the sum assured amount. But as a seller, insurance company gets the obligation of 5 lakh of rupees. Why? Because they have received a premium from you and they are obligated to pay you 5 lakh of rupees when you want to claim your right. That means you have been hospitalized and there was some bill raised and you want to settle it against the policy which you have already taken. So buyer, in the similarly, options are financial instrument where buyer gets the right to buy or sell, and to get this right he has to pay premium amount to the seller. Now he is not paying exactly to the seller, premium amount will be paid to the exchange, because it's an anonymous trade wherein buyer doesn't know who is the seller and seller doesn't know who is the buyer. So the buyer pays the premium money to the exchange and exchange will credit that, pay that money to the seller, that premium money. Okay, now who is obligated here in this financial instruments using options? It is the seller who gets the obligation. That means seller receives the premium, and since he is obligated for the trade till the time the expiry happens in that contract, he will also have to pay something called as margin money. So now there is a contrast. In futures, both buyers and seller pays margin money, but in the option contract, buyer pays the premium. He is not liable to pay margin money because he's already paid the premium to get that right. Now seller receives the premium and he also pays margin money. Okay, so what the buyer gets is the right to buy or sell at an agreed amount of the underlying asset on or before a future date. So that right is with the buyer till the expiry date of the contract, and obligation is with the seller till the expiry date. Okay, at an agreed price. Now this agreed price is what I was trying to show you in the drop down. That is, there are several prices on which anyone can take the right to buy and sell. These prices are called as strike prices, and the fee which you pay, which is exchange, is called as the option premium, and the fees which is paid is called as the option premium. So it is just like an insurance options. It provides insurance against the adverse movement to the buyers, okay, but allow for participation on the favorable side. Whereas, you know, what do I mean by this? If there is a buyer in the market and he wants to participate on the favorable side, it is then allowed both by futures and options. But in futures, you cannot cap your unfavorable side. So using options, your downside or the adverse movement or the loss zone can be plugged in by using options effectively. Okay, now since we have mentioned options are of two types, there is a call option. I'm just brisking through a call option. What does it gives? It gives the buyer the right not to buy, okay, and not the obligation at us to for a specified quantity of the underlying asset at a set strike price on or before a specific date. Okay, so call buyer in option, buyer is also called as the holder, seller is also called as the writer. So a call holder will pay premium, gets the right to buy. Okay, why is he doing so? Because he is expecting the prices to go up. Call writer, who is the seller of the call option, receives the premium, pays margin money, and gets the obligation to sell. Now this expectation of prices to go up or go down is very, very, very important in options. Now, this expectation is the individual's expectation, which is derived from understanding various factors of the product in which he is trying to trade an option. Now, for example, I am wanting to trade in gold options. Okay. Now, to do a strategy in option, I need to know the expectation because all strategies on options are made only on what kind of expectation a person has from the underlying product prices. So if I want to play on gold options, so I need to understand what all fundamental factors are there which impact the prices of gold and what is the impact of these fundamentals which is gonna be there in next 2 months or 3 months or 1 month. That is where I would want the instrument expiry to be. So if I feel that I understand gold fundamentals thoroughly and I expect in the next 2 months the prices are gonna go up for gold because of my understanding about the gold and my research which says the prices are gonna go up. Now, when I'm sure their prices are gonna go up, I might choose a call option wherein generally right to buy is given to the buyer wherein he is expecting the prices to go up. But on the contrary, okay, there is a seller of call option which feels, with the same in the online market, information asymmetry is there. It means same kind of information is available for all the participants. So with same kind of information, there is one person who feels the prices will go up in next 2 months. On the other side, there is a person who feels no price will not go up. So what he does is he becomes the seller of an option. Now, what is he trying to do? The seller of an option has a view that prices will go down. So he sells an option and gets the premium money today and remain in the contract by getting his margin money blocked. So once he gets out of the selling writing call the call option, he will be freed from this obligation. Okay, so call option holder always pays premium, gets right to buy, whereas call writer receive premium, pays margin and gets obligation to sell. Now, when is he obliged to sell? When the call option holder wants to exercise his right to buy, the call writer is obligated to sell. Okay. So buy call is generally used to hedge against risk of rising prices. Okay. Next is a put option. It is opposite to what was there in the call option. Call option, you get the right to buy. In put option, you get the buyer gets the right to sell, but he's not obligated to sell a specified quantity of the underlying asset at a strike price on or before a specified date. So put holder pays premium, gets the right to sell. And now why he would want to pay premium is when he's expecting the market prices to go down. So what is he trying to do? He's trying to fix in a price at a higher level by paying a premium that in case, say for example, there is a product whose value is 100 rupees. Okay. Now this product is sold by someone. So this someone who is the seller of the product feels that because of market forces, the product which he is selling at 100 right now might fetch 60 rupees in 1 month's time. This is what his analysis about the product is. So he's expecting prices to go down. So what he can do, he can buy a put option which says right to sell today at 100 rupees. So it means when the prices actually, if they actually go down, okay, maybe to say 70 rupees, so in that case, this person has the right to sell the product at 100 rupees, even though the price of market is 70 rupees for the product. So this is what he gets the right to sell at a higher price when the markets have already moved down. Okay. Now, this is where I said that anticipation is very, very important when you use options, because in case if your anticipation goes wrong, whatever money you have entered in with as a buyer is lost. See, for example, let us use the same example. I am a seller of a product. I am anticipating the prices to fall. And just to plug in this kind of a race, what I did was I bought the put option at 100 strike level. Now, to buy this put option, okay, what I need to shed from my pocket is the premium money. That is, if I get this right to sell at 100 rupees for a month's time, okay, this, you get rights limited to the expiry of the contract. So if I get this right to sell for 1 month, I need to pay money, which is called as a premium money. Now, as a buyer, if market goes otherwise, that is, this is where the price anticipation is important. I was anticipating prices to go down. Now, what if prices goes up? It goes to 110. In that case, what happens? My anticipation goes wrong. So if prices goes to 110, this option contract for me as a seller is worthless. Why? Because I have taken a right to sell at 100 rupees thinking that market prices will go down. But instead of prices going down, what has happened? The prices have gone up. So in this case, the premium which I have paid will be a straight loss for me. Because the intention of getting into this put option as a buyer of this put option was that prices will go down. And for this right, I have already paid the premium. But my analysis was wrong. The prices have gone upside. So it is a complete waste or loss for me to have entered into this contract by paying a premium amount. So if I would have paid a premium of 10 rupees to get the right to sell at 100 strike level, so it means that 10 rupees which I have paid is a straight loss to me if market has not behaved as per my anticipation. Now let us go back to the same example of the medical insurance, wherein you were paying 20,000 rupees as a premium to be insured for 5 lakh rupees, okay, for any ailment you may have for a year. But what if during this 1 year you have been healthy as ever and you have not used the hospital facility of hospitalization? So what happens to your 20,000 rupees? Is it that insurance company tells you that, okay, since you have not fallen ill last year, so you can again use the same 20,000 rupees which you have deposited for one more year of cover? No, it never happens. So once your, the year has gone by, your expiry date has gone by, and you have not been able to exercise your right, what happens? Your anticipation caused that you may fall ill. Now your anticipation has proven wrong. One full year you have not fallen ill to the extent that you have been hospitalized or some ailment was there. So what would happen is, because of this, since your anticipation was not correct, whatever money you have given to the market as premium is your straight loss. Okay, 20,000 rupees which you have paid as premium is not recoverable if your anticipation that you may fall ill goes wrong. So similarly, in options, anticipation is very important, because if your anticipation goes wrong, the premium you have paid is a complete loss. Okay, so writer of the put gets the premium, he pays the margin to the exchange and gets the obligation to buy. So if the put holder has an expectation that prices will go down, with same fundamentals, put writer, seller of the put option, thinks that prices will go up. So he is selling the put option and getting the premium because he knows that prices will not go down. And if prices will not go down, he will always have the money as profit which he has received, called as premium. Say for example, insurance company, okay, now if everybody takes insurance and everybody fall ill, insurance company will be in a deep loss, because for all, everyone, if they fall ill, insurance company is obligated to at least cover them up for the sum assured, right? So what is the profit of insurance company? The profit of a seller of an option is that on day one he receives the premium. Contract life is for 1 year. Whether you fall ill or not, he will get money on day one, which he could reinvest somewhere else, or which they could just deposit in banks and earn interest on that. You know, that is the other case. So on day one, when you receive the money, okay, you are on an advantage that what if the buyer of the option is not able to exercise his right? In that case, whatever money the seller has received as premium is his maximum profit, which he realizes on day one. So option is the only product which tells you what could be your maximum loss and what could be your maximum profit on day one. Whereas other instruments like futures, you will not be able to know your actual profit or loss till the time you exit your positions. Okay, so option is the product which tells you what would be your maximum loss and maximum profit on day one. So who uses this and why it is used, the put option? Generally, the buyer used to hedge against the fall in prices. He has a risk the prices could fall down, so the buyer buys a put option. Okay, now there are different kinds of options in the market. One is an American option, which says the buyer can exercise his right to buy or sell any time between the day of entering into the contract till the expiry date. So buyer gets the right to exercise on any day. You know, those options are called as American options, which are not there on any of the Indian exchanges, but definitely on the international exchanges, they also have American options. As of now, in Indian exchanges, take any underlying, any asset class, we right now have European options. Now, what does this mean? It means buyer can exercise their right only on the expiry day, not before that. So if you are a buyer of an option and in a European options and you want to exercise your right, you cannot exercise your right any day. You can exercise only on the expiry. You can exercise your right only on expiry. Okay. We also have plain vanilla options, maybe simple strategies using simple calls or only simple puts. Okay. They are called as plain vanilla options. Okay. But you can also combine them. You can combine call with puts with calls, and you can make different kinds of strategies. They are all plain vanilla options. Now, there are also called as structured combinations, which are called as exotic options. They are different variations of, you know, combinations of call and put options. Okay, these are called like exotic options. So very important, recap pointers to summarize up till now is option. It provides insurance against adverse movement to buyers. Maximum loss is limited to the extent of premium paid. Yes. For buyer, what is his maximum loss? Maximum loss is the premium which he pays upfront. Exchange traded options are free from counterparty risk. Yes, this is what I mentioned, that options are the contracts which are available both in OTC and exchange traded market. Now, in OTC market, it is a one-to-one contract whereby any party can default at any point in time. But options on the exchange are structured products wherein Exchange Clearing Corporation, they ensure that people who come and trade on the standard option products available, there is no counterparty default risk on the exchange platform. Participants can devise hundreds of hedging and trading strategies using options. By using futures, you can devise less strategies, but by options, you can devise n number of strategies using option. We'll come to this, you know, when we'll come to the strategy segment. Now, since we are in options, you have to understand the terminology. By now, you are clear. Option premium is the price paid by the buyer to acquire the right. This is what seller receives for getting the obligation. Expiration date. What is the expiration date? It is the date specified in the option contract on which the option expires or option matures. Okay, now what is the strike price or exercise price? These are the price levels, you know, specified in the option contracts at which the underlying may be bought or sold. We have seen that scroll down price. It was a complete list of prices on which you can buy and sell an option. Now, this is very important. Moneyness. When we talk about option, moneyness of the option becomes very important. Now, what do I mean by moneyness of an option? Understand. We'll talk about this because moneyness of an option is directly linked to what could be the premium for the product. So when you talk about moneyness, there are three terms involved: in the money, at the money, out of the money. Understand, for a call option, I bought a call option at 100 strike level by paying 10 rupees premium. Now market has moved to 120. What has happened? I have the right to buy a product at 100 rupees for which I have paid a premium of 10 rupees. But now market is at 120. It means I am in a profitable situation. Even though market is at 120, I have the right to buy at 100 only. So by 20 rupees, I am in the money. Yes. If I have bought the right to buy, I bought a call option at 100 rupees and market goes down to 80 rupees. It means I have right to buy at 100 rupees, but it is a waste because the market price of the product is 80. So it means my option has gone out of the money, whereby if market is at 80 and I still want to exercise my right at 100, I would lose 20 rupees. That is out of the money. And when I have chosen 100 rupees as a strike price, I've taken a call option at 100 rupees by paying premium, and market price also comes at rupees 100. It means my strike price and market price, current price, are same. It is called as add the money. Now this was the example when I have already taken a position. Now understand, market price is at 100 and there are many strike prices above 100 and below 100. There was a series of strike prices. So as a trader, if you trade at the money, market price is at 100 and there is a strike price also at 100. So this situation is called at the money, and at the money options you have some premium which is higher. That is today's premium at the current price. Now, since we are in options, we have many prices below 100 and many strike prices above 100. So if market is at 100 at the money, okay, 100, and I want to buy the right, okay, I want to buy the right at 80 rupees. It means market today is at 100 and I want to buy a 80 rupees strike call option. It means right now I am wanting to buy a profitable option. This is called as in the money options. Okay, when market is at 100, you want to buy a call option at 80 rupees. That means you want to buy straight away 20 rupees profit option. Now, any strike as a call buyer, any strike price below the current market price is in the money. So to buy in the money options, you have to pay more premium than at the money. More in the money, more premium you have to pay, because on day one you are entering a profitable situation. Now market is at 100, you want to take the right to buy at 110. It means today only you have that 10 rupees loss. You know, market is at 100, you don't buy at 100, you say I want to buy at a strike price of 110. So as compared to 100, you are taking out of the money strike prices, you are taking call options on out of the money strike prices. So the premium on out of the money strike levels are lesser than at the money. So this is where at different strike levels, looking at the premium, people may entry and exits using different strategies. So moneyness becomes very important. So in the money for call option is, in the money for call option is when your strike prices are lesser than the current market price. Current market price was 100, and if you take a right to buy at 70 rupees at a lesser price, it means you are already buying an in the money option by 30 rupees. So you have to pay more premium. Okay. In the money for put is when your strike prices are more than the current price. Okay. Now put option is the right to sell. Market is at 100 rupees. I want to have the right to sell at 150. Strike. Market is at 100 and I'm taking the right to sell at 150. So it means I am going for an in the money put option. Okay. So when market is at 100 and I'm trying to take that 150 strike level, taking the right to sell at 150, I need to pay more margin money in that case. Okay. At the money for bold call and put is same. It is when your current price is same as the strike price, you deal on those at the money levels, the margin paid is less. Out of the money is for call when your strike price levels are more than the current price. Current price is 100 and you want to buy right to buy at 120 level. It looks foolish, but people, they do this to pay less premium and still have the right to buy. Okay. Put option when your current price is greater than the strike prices, it is called as out of the money put option. Okay. Now, when we again deal with the option, there is a term called as intrinsic value. What do you mean by intrinsic value? It is the amount by which option is in the money. That means it is the difference between the strike price and the current price. Say, for example, today I have taken a right to buy at the money at 100 rupees. Okay. Now market, that is the current market price, it goes to 120. It means I have the right to buy at 100. Market has gone to 120. It means I am better off by 20 rupees. So that 20 rupees is the intrinsic value in the option. Okay. For out of the money options, which is a loss proposition, there is no intrinsic value. So for call option, current price minus strike price is the intrinsic value. Okay. Where current price should be greater than the strike price. For put option, strike price minus the current value, that is in the money situation, will be the intrinsic value. Okay. Now, intrinsic value is the value which you get on the expiry of the contract if it is a cash settled options. Okay. Now, along with intrinsic value, there is something called as time value. That is, it is the value over and above the intrinsic value that the market places on the options. It means, say for example, I'm taking an example. Market is at 100. Okay. You want to buy a call option at 80. It means you are already trying to buy 80, 20 rupees in the money option. So that 20 is the intrinsic value today, but it will also have something called as the premium figure will have 20 rupees. You would see the premium for this 80 rupees in the money will be say 30 rupees. The premium will be 30 rupees. Now in this 30 rupees, 20 rupees is the intrinsic value and 10 rupees is time value. That is over and above the intrinsic value. Okay. The market adds on some more value, which is called as a time value to the option premium. Okay. That means this is the value of the continuing exposure to the movement in the underlying, because there would be some time left to the expiry of the contract. So to take care of the movement in the prices of the product for the remaining period. If, for example, there is an option which will expire in 10 days from now. Okay. So 20 rupees is the intrinsic value and 10 rupees in that premium will be the time value, which could be because of that 10 days remaining time in the option to expire. It could be because of interest rate and volatility, of the underlying product. So that that 10 rupees is nothing but called the time value. So in the premium, in the current market, you will find it is the premium value is the combination of intrinsic and time value. But on expiry, what happens? The time value becomes zero, and it is only the difference, actual difference between the current price and the strike price is what is paid for cash settlement in the money options. Okay, now let us just see how it is seen when it is planted. So remember, I have told you the option is only contract in which profit is known to the person and loss is also ascertained to the person who deals in the product. So when these profits and losses are ascertained, so we could make a payoff diagram, which is called a payoff, net payoff. Okay, understand. View is very important. It is individualistic. So buy call option, view was bullish. The prices are going to go up. So somebody bought 1 month call on gold with the strike price of 48,000. Okay, premium to trade here was 280 rupees per 10 gram. Okay, now the strike levels was per 10 gram. Okay, so it is premium is also 280 rupees per 10 gram. Now what has happened? The view was bullish. See, on this table in front of you, what has happened? Now gold options, they have a strike price, minimum strike price interval of 100 rupees. Okay, so for understanding, we have seen, you know, today's price was 48,000 on which the position has been taken. So we have strike prices below 48,000 with the gap of 100 and above 48,000 with the gap of 100, different strike prices. Okay, now I have right to buy. For this, I have already made a premium payment. So as a buyer, my loss cannot exceed my premium amount. This is what we have learned. So net premium at all price level is 280 rupees. Now understand, if market goes up from 48,000, that was the anticipation, view is bullish. So from 48,000, if market goes up to 48,600, what happens? My option will give me 600 rupees profit. See, look at the second column, option payoff. Okay, I have made a net premium. I have paid premium 280 rupees. So what is my net profit out of this option? Having this option is 600 minus 280 is 320 rupees. Okay, anything above 48,000, any price movement above 48,000 is what my anticipation as bullishness. So it will give me profit on the upside. But if the prices goes to 47,600 against my expectation, what will happen? I will have zero payoff from the option. Why because I have right to buy at 48,000. Market price is 47,600. So I will not execute my option because it is expensive. So I will leave these option contracts. So payoff from option is zero. But in this case, when market has gone against me, I have already paid the premium. So what my net payoff would be is minus 280. So if we calculate, you know, for all the strike levels, if we calculate the net payoff, so it shows that if market goes against my expectation, that is, if market falls below 48,000, I have a fixed loss of 280 rupees. And if market goes above 48,000, okay, to 41,000, what happens? I recover 100 rupees. I have right to sell at 48,000 when market is at 48,100. So I'm better off by 100 rupees, but I have paid a premium. So at 48,100, my net payoff is still negative, minus 180, because 100 rupees has been recovered, you know, in ways of premium. So in this way, 48,280 is the break even, wherein if market goes up from 48,000 and it reaches 48,280, my premium gets completely covered, which I have paid to take this right, and any movement above this gives me profit. So the buyer of a call option today on day one knows what is his limited loss was of 280 rupees. He knows his limited loss. He knows his break even at 48,280. And since he is bullish, any price movement above, you know, 48,000 will always recover his premium payment and result into profit going ahead. So buyer of an option has a limited loss, unlimited profit potential beyond break even. Now understand about seller of an option. Now if there is a buyer, there is also a seller, that is the writer of the call option. What has happened? Seller of the call option has a limited profit. He knows his profit. Why? Because he receives 280 rupees. That is what is his maximum profit from that option. Now, what will happen is seller of the option has the view that prices will fall. So if prices remain below 48,000, he makes a maximum profit of 280 rupees, which premium he has received. Now, if seller's anticipation goes wrong, what will happen? The profit will reduce slowly, slowly till 48,280. That is 280 is his premium. So beyond 48,000, if the market anticipation proves wrong for the seller, his profit gets eroded. And after 48,280, he comes into a loss proposition, which is unlimited. Okay. So loss for the seller is unlimited in the option contract, and his profit is limited to the premium what he has received, and he has to pay margin money to the exchange. Similarly, for a put option, the view is buyer of the put option view is bearish. He buys a 1 month put on gold with strike price of 48,000, premium 280. I'm just explaining the same with same figures. Okay, now at 48,000, I have taken the right to sell at 48,000 when prices fall down. So if prices fall down from 48,000 to 48,400, so intrinsic value, I get 400 rupees. Yes or no? What I get is right to sell when prices goes down, but 48,400 is when prices goes up. Okay, so as a buyer of put option, if prices goes up, my option will be worthless. It will give me a zero payoff. Okay, so if from 48,000 prices goes to 48,400, option payoff, option return is zero. But I've already paid a premium of 280 rupees to have this option, so that will be my maximum loss. But what if prices goes as per my anticipation, prices falls and they go to 47,400? So 600 is the intrinsic profit I make. Intrinsic value, you know, I am in the money by 600. Why? Because I have taken right to sell at 48,000 and market price is 47,400. So 600 is what I receive from the options, and I have made a payment of 280 rupees. So my net payoff become 320 rupees. So this is the view. Market goes down, I make money. If market goes against my view, I lose money. And what is the maximum loss is the loss of premium which has been paid by me to acquire this right. So this is for the buyer. Okay, so buyer of a put gets a limited loss. Again, loss is limited to the buyer to the amount of the premium paid. Okay, and his profit is unlimited till the price of that product reaches zero. Till that time his profit is unlimited, and his break even is how much? 47,720, because 280 is the premium which he has paid to acquire this right. So if there is a buyer of put, there has to be a seller of put somewhere, right? So seller of put has a view that prices will go up. Price will go up. So at 48,000, he has sold a put option, got the obligation to buy and receive a premium of 280 rupees with an anticipation that prices are gonna go up from 48,000. If prices remain on the upside, so his maximum profit is rupees 280, which he has received as premium. But what if the seller of puts anticipation is wrong and price started falling below 48,000 level? So first it will eat away the premium which he has received, and then it will go in the negative trajectory. So loss for the seller of put is unlimited till the price of the product reaches zero, and he has a fixed profit of 280 rupees which he receives as a premium. So what is the overall, I mean, we have already discussed about it, but I will touch again. So what is the difference between an option and a future? Future contracts, it is a contract to buy and sell at a predetermined price. Okay, you determine a price and time, and both buyers and sellers are obligated till the product is exited. But in options, the contract, it is a contract, you know, which gives right to the buyer and obligation to the seller. So in futures, both buyer and seller are obligated. In options, only seller is obligated, buyer gets the right. Futures are only exchange traded products. Options are both exchange traded and OTC products. In future, margin is paid both by buyers and sellers, which gets refunded once the position is squared off. In options, buyer pays the upfront premium, seller receives the upfront premium, and margin payment is done only for, margin blocking is done only from the seller's side. Okay. Now, in the future contract, the future price reflects everything, that is the holding cost and market perceptions. But in option contracts, prices are given, strike prices are given. So what reflects all the sentiments, all the holding cost, it is the premium which reflects the holding cost and market perception and sentiments. In futures, you can square off positions anytime. In options as well, you can square off positions anytime. But as a buyer, you have no obligation. And if market goes against you, it means I'm a buyer of a call option. I've taken right to buy at 100. Now, if market goes against me as a buyer of call option, I was anticipating prices to go up, but market has gone against me. It means market has fallen. So I am not obligated to exit. In futures, both buyer and sellers are obligated to exit to get the actual profit and loss. If they don't exit, the notional profit and loss can increase and decrease anytime. But if as a buyer of an option, your position runs into losses, you need not exit. You are not supposed to exit because that contract becomes worthless. So you are not obligated to exit. Okay. Now, let us just go ahead. So what are the benefits of having an option trade? First is, for the buyers, no margin blocking. Okay, margin calls is only for option writer. So no margin blocking and unblocking, no margin calls. The buyer pays one time premium upfront to the writer. Okay, option buyer knows exactly how much they have to pay, making it easier to arrange for funds in advance, because that is the premium amount which they have to pay upfront. So they know what would be the money which they have to pay. So no daily M2M loss payment or arranging of margin. The option buyer also is aware of the maximum risk. What is the maximum risk? Is the premium which he has paid. Okay. Now, ways in which option position can be closed, that is important. Options can get settled by cash, or it can get settled by delivery. In commodities, all option contracts are settled by delivery. Okay. Now, what are the factors which impact the prices of these commodities? There are many factors, like prices in the international markets impact the prices of products in local markets as well. Currency rates and interest rates and their movement impact the prices of any of the underlying commodities. Geopolitical factors like global and Indian scenario, trade policies and regulation, tariff and non-tariff barriers, taxes, quotas, sanctions for export and import, they all impact in terms of availability or shortage of the product, and hence price of the commodity moves. Economic factors like economic conditions, recession will have a different demand supply scenario and availability of product. Inflation phase will have a different scenario. Growth phase has a different scenario. Trends in the fast growing economies as the consumers and demand is high in these areas will have a different scenario for the product and the valuation of commodities. Okay. Now, some commodity specific events like availability of the product. That is the inventory levels. How much product is already stacked in raw material and finished good form? Plus, what is the availability of the product and demand of the product in different scenarios? So demand and supply scenario and inventory levels also play an important role in determining what would be the price of the product in the market. Okay. Now, understand, because of all of these factors, there are distortions in the underlying prices. And because there are distortions in the underlying prices, derivatives, which are options, are based on these underlying products. So if there is a movement in underlying product because of the factors which we have just seen, so there would be a definite movement in the option prices as an instrument as well. Okay. Now, since option is a premium product wherein premiums are given and taken, okay, buyer gives the premium, seller takes the premium. So we have already seen that in future market, it is the price who has all the holding cost and market perceptions. In options, it is premium who has all the holding cost and perceptions. So what are the factors which change the premium? So price change in the underlying future contracts or underlying commodity, if the price changes, the premium of the option contract with the same underlying will be changed. Okay. Second factor which influences the premium is the strike price as compared to the market price. This is where we talked about moneyness of the option. So in the money, options will have higher premium. At the money, options will have premium, and OTMs will have lesser premiums. So if you want to trade at the money options, you pay higher premium than OTM. If you want to trade in the money options, you pay further higher premiums than what it was at the money. And if you want to trade at out of the money strikes, you pay a relatively lesser premium than what was there at the money strike level. So the strike levels at which you want to trade determines what is the premium you have to pay or receive. Third factor is time until expiration. You remember we talked about time value. So the options which has more time to expire, the buyers will have to pay a higher premium for those options. If I want to enjoy the right to buy or sell for 2 months compared to I enjoy the right to buy or sell for only 15 days. So where will we have more premium charged? For the right when more number of days are there. So 60 days option will have a higher premium as compared to 15 days option. So time until expiration also plays a role in determining what would be the premium for the product. Price volatility of the underlying asset. Now, volatility is there. Volatility is nothing but the movement in the prices of the underlying. So if the volatility is higher and is increasing, so it means the premium on those options will also go up. And if volatility is less in the product or is reduced from the current level, the impact of volatility on the premium will bring the premium value down if the volatility is less. Now, important factor, interest rates. So risk-free interest, if interest rates are increased, they will have an impact on the premiums of the product. And if interest rates are decreased, they will also have an impact on the premium. So these five factors are the major factors on by which the premium in options are influenced. Okay. Now, just it's been depicted in a pictorial form depicted to show you what is the impact. So if you talk about call option, and if underlying call and put both are there, okay, let us just talk about call option first. So if underlying prices, okay, if underlying prices increase, the call premium increases. Okay, if underlying prices are decreased, the call premium will decrease. In put option, if underlying prices are increased, the premium on put will decrease. And if underlying prices is decreased, the premium input option will increase. Time to expiration. It means if the time to expiry increases, okay, long, it means more days are there for an option to expire.
premium for both call and put option will increase. If time to expiration is reduced, so the premium of both call and put options will reduce. Okay, time till expiration, its impact will go down in the premium value. Volatility. If volatility increases, so call premium increase, put premium increase. If volatility reduces, both call and put premium reduces. If interest rate increases, call premium will go up, put premium will come down. If interest rates are reduced, call premiums come down and put premiums goes up. Strike prices. If strike prices are increased, the call premium goes down. If strike prices are reduced, call premium goes up. If strike prices are increased, put premium goes up. If strike prices are reduced, your put premium goes down. Okay, so this is where, you know, these are different areas whereby you have to understand when and how premiums are going up and going down. So these premium going up and going down, these factors are called as option greeds. Okay, now there are five kinds of option greeds: delta, gamma, theta, vega, rho. These are called first order derivatives, which are called as the first order derivatives: delta, vega, theta, and rho. Gamma is the second order derivative, and we have other Vana, Volga, and other second order derivatives as well. Okay, but popularly these five are the, you know, predominantly understood Greeks. Now, what is this delta? Remember, what was the first factor of price influencing was the changes in the underlying prices. So if underlying price change, the price of option premium will also change. So what is delta? Delta measures the change in the option value with respect to the change in the underlying futures contract or the underlying prices. So that is the same. So what all factors they impact the premium, they are given special name like delta, which means changes in the premium because of changes in the underlying price of the asset. Okay, the rate of change is called as the delta. So delta measures the rate of change of an option value with respect to the price change in the underlying future contracts. It is the sensitivity of option premium to the underlying price of the asset. So delta ranges from 0 to 1 for call option, 0 to minus 1 for the put option. Okay, now if the delta is approaching 1 or minus 1, 1 for call and minus 1 for put, it means options are going in the money, deep in the money. Okay, if delta are approaching 0, from 1 it is approaching to 0 for call option and minus 1 to 0 for put option, it means options are getting out of the money. And at the money, delta generally is around 0.5. When strike price and current market price are just trying to equate, they're trying to reach a situation which is called as at the money, the delta becomes 0.5. It comes around 0.5 level. Okay, now what is gamma? Gamma is a second order derivative. It is a derivative of delta. Okay, delta is a derivative of the underlying price movement. So gamma, what does it depict? It depicts that change in delta. Delta was measuring the change in the premium because of change in underlying, and delta is also a figure which ranges from 0 to 1 for call options and 0 to minus 1 for put options. But this delta is also not fixed. So the rate of change of delta with respect to change in the underlying prices is called as gamma. Okay, so if underlying price changes by 1 rupee, what is the change in the premium is measured by delta. If underlying price changes by 1 rupee, what is the change in delta is measured by gamma. Okay, now what is vega? Vega is the change in the value of premium because of change in 1% of volatility of the underlying product. Okay, so if I say the underlying product volatility was 10%, now if it goes to 11%, what is the impact on the premium is determined by vega. Or when that 1% is reduced from 10 to, if the volatility is reduced to 9%, then what is the impact of that 1% change in the value of the option premium is determined by vega. What is theta? Theta is the time value of an option which erodes as and day passes by and as and when we are reaching the expiry day. So it means every day when it is passed and less number of days are left, so this time value is reduced. On expiry there is zero time value, so this is called as the decay factor, time decay. So with lesser number of days going, lesser nearing the expiry, what is the impact on the option premium is measured by theta. Okay, now there is something called as rho. It is called as the change in the option premium due to change in the interest rates, risk-free interest rate. So if risk-free interest rates are increased by 1 point or decreased by 1 point, what is the impact of this change on the option value is measured by rho. Okay, a lot of strategies revolve around delta, gamma, theta, vega, rho. So if I want to summarize these Greeks, so the buy, you know, if I want to say futures, if we buy and sell, okay, if we buy a future, buying a future means a positive delta, selling a future means a negative delta. So future has delta one, future contracts delta is always one. They don't have gamma, theta, vega and rho. If you buy a call option, your delta is positive, gamma is positive, theta is negative, vega is positive, rho is positive. If you sell a call option, your delta is negative, gamma is negative, theta is positive, vega is negative, rho is negative. Okay, if you buy a put option, your delta, theta and rho are negative, gamma and vega are positive. But if you sell a put option, your delta and your delta, theta and rho are positive and your gamma and vega are negative. So this is something you have to always keep in mind while defining strategies using options, that what is the impact of underlying prices and how these Greeks behave and what is the impact of these Greeks on the option valuations. So as of now, we are coming to the option contracts available in commodity segments. We have options as underlying, with underlying as futures, and we also have option with underlying as the physical product. So this is, we are understanding the option on commodity futures. So as of now we have five contracts in which this option on future is there, that is gold 1 kg, silver 30 kgs, crude oil 100 barrels, copper 2.5 metric ton and zinc 5 metric ton. So what does this mean, option on futures? Now when we have option on futures, it means the underlying is not a commodity, it is a future contract. I'm taking an example of gold futures contract. Okay, now understand, gold option contract, if it is an option on commodity, that is a gold option, the underlying becomes a gold future contract which is already traded on MCX. Now these contracts, they have minimum 31 strike prices available, minimum, maximum could be many. So these option on gold should have minimum 31 strike prices, out of which 15 should be in the money, 15 out of the money and one at the money strike price. Settlement, how these contracts are settled? On expiry, okay, option position gets converted into an underlying future contract. If I mean, sure, some of us are familiar with equity options. On expiry, options get converted into option gets settled by cash. But here in commodities, options on expiry get converted into the underlying product, which is a future contract. Okay. On exchange, we have European style options. Trading hours are same on MCX. Trading for these options are available from 9 o'clock in the morning till 11:30 in the summertime and 11:55 in winters. Okay. So how does this conversion happens? Long call gets converted into long futures, buying of futures. Long put gets converted into selling of futures. Short call gets converted into selling of futures. Short put positions get converted into buying of futures. Okay. This is options on future. Now on expiry, you know, the people can trade, they can enter and exit anytime, but people who have open positions and till expiry, how does these contracts end? So there could be three situations, you know, but towards settlement, that is in the money, at the money, out of the money, but towards the end, there is a concept of close to the money introduced. It means first ATM will be found out. Now what is ATM? The strike price, which is closest to the daily settlement price of the underlying future contract. Okay. So the closest price would be called as ATM. Now taking this ATM, two option series above, strike prices above, and two strike prices below this ATM are clubbed as CTM, close to the money. So any option open position which falls into close to the money, wherein you have two in the money, two out of the money strikes, two in the money strikes, and one at the money strikes, for people who are in this CTM, who fall in this CTM band, they can exercise, they can get the right, the buyers, okay, buyer in the CTM band gets the right to exercise. We are in European options, so on expiry they get the right to exercise. So if they fall in the CTM band, they can exercise their right only by giving something called as explicit instructions to the exchange. Okay. Now buyers, long position holders falling in CTM, if they don't give this explicit instructions of exercising, their position expires worthless. Okay. All out of the money options on expiry expire worthless. In the money options, all in the money options get automatically exercised on expiry and converted into future contracts on expiry. Now, even though being in the money, there are people who don't want their positions to get converted into future contracts. So what they have to do is they have to give contrary instructions to the exchange that even after being in the money, we don't want our positions to be converted into futures on expiry. So in this case, their positions are considered worthless. Okay. And whatever profits they were getting by being in the money is not given to them. It is worthless. Okay. This is what happens when we talk about options on futures. Now to make you explain this CTM process, we have this thing CTM. If suppose my underlying price was 45,010. So what is the nearest strike is 45,000. So 45,000 becomes ATM, and two prices above, two strike prices, 45,100, 45,200, and two strike prices below 45,000, that is 44,900, 44,800. This band of five strike prices becomes CTM. Okay. Now, when the underlying price is exactly in midway, okay, the strike price interval is 100 rupees and the underlying price is it comes exactly in midway, that is 45,050. In this case, there would be no ATM. In this case, for calculating the CTM, two strike prices above this 45,050, that is 45,100 and 45,200, and two strike prices below 44,900 become CTM. Okay, and if the underlying settlement price is 45,060, in that case ATM is 45,100 and CTM is two strike prices below 45,100, that is 45,000 and 44,900, and two strike prices above 45,200 and 45,300. So these five strike prices becomes CTM. Okay, now I mean just skip this, okay, but this is important, so let me just tell you what happens. This is, you know, on devolvement. Devolvement is very important. Now what do we mean by devolvement? On expiry of this option in futures, when your option contracts gets converted into a future contract, it is called as devolvement. Just to give an example, what happens in this devolvement period, say for example, I've just taken an arbitrary example that this is a November 2020 date. Okay, option contracts gets expire on what date? Any idea? It gets expire on the 25th. It is written highlighted here. The option contract expires on 25th. It is an option on futures. So on 25th, end of the day trading, all in the money open positions and CTM positions for which expiration instructions have been received gets converted into future contracts. Okay, now at what price this is devolvement will happen is the price of underlying future contract daily settlement price. Okay, now if this is a November expiry contract, the underlying future contract for gold will be the 4th December contract. Okay, so 25th is the expiry. Now understand, when you are in option, you pay premium, but on expiry what happens, all in the money buyers, they get converted into position, gets converted into futures. So as a buyer you have paid premium, but on conversion into futures you need to pay margin money. Okay, so 4 working days prior, if expiry is on 25th, 19th, 20th, 23rd and 24th, you get something called as sensitivity report from the this is how devolvement happens. Just let me give you a brief on, let us just go ahead. Now there are contracts on goods. Now the only difference between option on futures and option in good is that on expiry, rather than converting into future contracts, the contracts go for delivery. All the concepts are same otherwise. Okay, now let us just slightly go quickly to the strategies of options. You know, we have understood till Greeks, then I've just explained you about the product. We are going to strategies now. With options you can make n number of strategies. So strategies which I'll cover is, one is the hedging strategy, which involves a single option and a physical position. That physical position could be the physical underlying position or a position in futures. We'll see put and call, parity, arbitrage, positions. Then we'll talk about combination strategies. Now, as a hedging strategy, just few example. One is a protective put, the other is a covered call. Now, very important point here is, when we talk about options, we have to be clear about the market view which one person makes. It is not a view that other person is giving you. It is the view you have to make about the market. So wherever you see market outlook, that is the outlook of a person for the market. Okay, now understand, protective put as a hedging strategy. Market outlook of an individual is cautiously bullish. It means market is bullish, but because of some fundamental factors, the person feels that market can fall as well. Okay, but he wants to make money on the upside. So what he can do is, he can buy the underlying or a future contract and he can buy a put along with it. Now what happens? Say for example, I buy a gold futures at 45,000. I am, what was the view? Cautiously bullish. Then I'm expecting prices to go up. That is why I have bought future contracts. Only when prices goes up, I will make money. But I am cautiously bullish that there could be some events coming in next 5 days whereby prices can go down as well. So how could I protect my loss on this derivative on futures?
Okay, we can do it by buying a put. So what has happened is we buy gold futures at 45,000 and we buy put at 44,900. Why? Because 100 rupees is the loss which I can bear. I want the downside protection. So what has happened? If the prices goes to 44,700, futures will give you a loss of 300. Anything going above, the view was cautiously bullish. It means market will be bullish, but there could be some dips on the downside. So from 45,000, if market goes to 45,300, futures will give me a profit of 300. But now what has happened? Since I have introduced option, so at if market falls, you know, below 44,900, because 44,900 is the strike price on which I have bought a put option by paying premium. So if market falls below 44,900, put option will give me profit. And if market goes up from 44,900, this option becomes redundant for me, because I have taken a right to sell at 44,900. Now by doing this, what is the net result? The net result is I am expecting markets to go up. I want to play on the upside, but at the same time, I want to limit the risk on the downside to rupees 100. Because I feel markets can go down, and in commodities, if market goes down, it goes down sharply. So you have to protect yourself. So my risk, capacity of taking risk was 100 rupees. So I protected myself at 100 rupees. So let market fall to at any level. Maximum I could use is 100 rupees, which I could define by entering, making a combination of option with a future at these levels. I could make the risk as zero as well, but for that I need to pay more premium, because I'm buying put. I need to pay more premium and come to at the money level, you know. So it means more premium will be paid here. So the payoff would look like this, whereby you are protecting on the downside but leaving the upside open. Okay, now the second strategy which was mentioned there is was covered call. Understand, it says market outlook is of a person is neutral to slightly bullish. It means he is expecting markets not to fall. He is expecting markets to be either neutral or slightly bullish, or so slightly go up. Now in this case, risk is limited, reward is limited. This is what you want to create a situation. But what happens, understand, gold futures we buy at 45,000. Now my view is not bullish or not cautiously bullish. My view is neutral to slightly bullish. It means market is looking bullish, but it will not fall. But that bullishness is also not very high. It is slightly bullish. So what I can do is I buy gold futures. Okay. And gold futures will again behave similarly. If it is, I bought at 45,000, it reaches 45,300, I make 300 rupees profit. If it goes, it falls to 44,700, I make 300 loss. But now by, okay, that was a hood. Yes, covered call. What has happened? I write a call at 45,200. It means I am neutral to slightly bullish. So on day one, I fixed my price on the upside at 45,200. My analysis shows that market can go up to this level and beyond, but I am happy and sure with this level, 200 rupees profit. So what I did, I sold a call. I sold a call at 45,200, whereby by selling a call, I also received some premium. Now what happens by selling a call at 45,200, any price going beyond 45,200 will give me loss in the option, and any price below 45,200, my option will not be exercised. Now in doing this, what happens? Understand, my view was neutral to slightly bullish. So it means I am not talking about strike levels, you know, below 45,000. To leave them. So I am trying to make 200 rupees profits on day one, because market is neutral to slightly bullish. So I'm not waiting for, you know, that bullishness to happen and then make money. What I did was, using options, I blocked that profit for me. Immediately I take that profit for, I entered into a strategy. But what happens, shortcoming of this strategy is any movement beyond 45,200, my maximum profit remains 200. This is what I have fixed for myself. So 45,000 till 45,200, maximum profit which I can get is at 45,200 level, that is rupees 200. Okay. Any price movement above will give me maximum 200 as profit. Now, the view is neutral to slightly bullish. But what if your view goes wrong and market starts falling? You have an unlimited loss open on the downside. Okay, so the figure looks like this. Oh my god. And this situation happens only when you are very sure about your view, that okay, market is neutral to slightly bullish, so I just book that 200 rupee gap and be happy. But I have to be sure that market doesn't fall. But since we are in options, and I have told you that we can make n number of strategies with options, with this same setup, I could also limit my downside. What I need to do is, I need to add a put option to this combination. Now, moment and I add a put option to this combination, it is called as a collar structure or a covered call. Now, it is called as a collar structure or range forward. Now, understand how range forward will work. You know, this is how you keep on adding more strategies to the market. I'm getting a call. Just hold on, please. Okay, range forward. I'm sorry for that call coming in between. What you can do is, you can buy a gold future. You can buy a put option to protect yourself on downside, and you can limit on the upside. Okay, now what was the end result out of this? See, because of adding put option, what has happened? By buying a put at the money, I need to pay 120 rupees as premium. By selling call, I receive 100 rupees as a premium. So overall, 20 rupees is what is going out of my pocket. So what happens? The net result is, you know, in the previous example, maximum profit was 200. So by adding a put option at the money, it has reduced my profit by 20 rupees. Maximum is 180 rupees profit. But I have protected my downside as well, that in case my view was neutral to slightly bullish, but in case if market goes down, so maximum I could lose is 20 rupees. So what I've done is, I have protected my downside also. So with options, you can do n number of strategies by adding in more things. I've got a input that, you know, I have to just be a bit quicker because I have less time, 15 minutes or odd for the session. I'll try and cover more strategies. Put and call parity. It's an arbitrage strategy wherein it is used by many market players to do a conversion and a reversion arbitrage. Now, when we do put call strategy, next slide becomes very important. Now, this is something which is astonishing. By using options, you can make future contracts. Now, this put call arbitrage strategy involves both futures and options to take the arbitrage. It means, if I buy a future contract, it is the buying future, but instead of buying future, if I can buy a call option and sell a put option at the same strike level of the same expiry, it acts as a future contract. It gives me as a future returns of a future contract. So these are called as synthetic equivalents. So rather than buying a future, I buy call and sell put in this combination at the same strike price. It is same as buying the futures. Sell a future, it is using options, synthetic equivalent is as a sell future is you sell call and buy put simultaneously at the same strike price. So this is how you know you can create synthetic futures for different products. Now, this put call parity says that at the same strike price, you have both call and put option. So if the future price is there, okay, and at the same strike price, for this arbitrage to not exist, you should have no difference between the call and put premium at the same strike levels. Now, if there is a difference between call and put premium at the same strike levels, there is an arbitrage opportunity which exists. So generally in arbitrage, what we do is we buy in one segment and we sell in the other segment, same product. So what we do here is we buy a future contract and we sell a future contract, only then arbitrage will happen. But in this, using options, what we do is we buy a future contract and we sell a synthetic future, which means buy put and sell call combination at the same strike prices on which the future is bought. So it means I am creating a sell future by combination of buy put and sell call. So this kind of combination, which involves buying a future, buying a put and selling a call at same strike prices, are called as conversion arbitrage. Reversion arbitrage is when I sell a future contract, I buy a call and sell a put at same strike prices. If there is a gap, it gives me something called as a reversal arbitrage. Now, arbitrage is a riskless profit. So if you are able to block this arbitrage using options, it means you have no risk, market risk, no delta, gamma, theta, vega, rho impacting your profit. You are just blessed with a riskless profit. Now, this is called as a long combo. Market outlook of a person is very bullish. Risk is unlimited, reward is unlimited. Why? Because he is bullish, so he will keep the downside open. So what is he trying to do? He is trying to do a strategy whereby he buy an OTM call and sell an OTM put. What he is trying to do is understand if the market price is at 100 today and person is very, very bullish. So what he is trying to do, he cannot leave the downside open because market is not in his hand. So what is he doing is he's trying to create a band in which by using market options only from 80 to 120, if market is anywhere between these levels, 40 rupees band, he makes a negative 100 rupees as the loss. Okay. Now, if the price goes beyond 120 to an unlimited zone, he makes an unlimited profit. So it means he is very, very bullish. So being bullish is good, but he is trying to protect himself in a way whereby in case if market remains between 80 and 120, he is incurring only 1 rupee loss, market has fallen, but beyond that is his pure profit. Okay. Now, there are some combination spreads which are used by introducing and involving both call and put. Now, one is called as a straddle. Straddle is usually done, is a combination which is usually done by involving one by buying a call and buying a put at the same strike prices, wherein market outlook of a person is very large movement in either direction. So what he does is he buys call and put at the market price, at the money. Because of this, what happens? Maximum premium will go, but in case if market it rushes on either side, either it falls or it goes up, this person with this strategy makes profit either side. If profit goes up, he makes a profit. If market prices goes down, he makes a profit. So risk is limited, rewards are unlimited. Say for example, buy call and buy put at 45,000 levels by paying a premium of 300. This person is expecting, you know, some market event whereby markets can go anywhere. He's not sure, but he knows that market would be volatile. So by doing this, what happens? Moment, you know, whether market goes up or down,
you know, by paying a 300 rupees premium, he is sure that once my premium amount is covered, I will be into an unlimited profit zone. Okay, now that was a long straddle. This is a short straddle, whereby, you know, the market outlook of a person is neutral. He feels that market is in a range. It will not break the range. So what he wants to do is he wants to take the maximum premium out of the market. So what he does is he sells a call and a put at the same strike price, that is at the money, and take the maximum premium, wherein risk is unlimited, reward is limited. Why risk is unlimited? Because market is neutral. He knows market will not fall. Okay. So what he did was he took a strategy whereby he is taking in most of the premium from the market. But as we are in options, this downside can be protected by adding in two more kinds of options. So once that downside is protected, it becomes a butterfly strategy, condor butterfly. Now, like long straddle, there is something called as long straddle. Market outlook is, yes, large move in either direction. But what has happened? Somebody is not ready to pay more margin of add the money. So what he did was he bought call, he bought pull, but at a out of the money strike prices. So what has happened? His premium outflow has been reduced, but because of that premium outflow reduced, what has happened? His profit break evens have gone slightly farther, but he is happy by paying even less premium than straddle. He is making money on either side if market goes on the upside or downside. Okay, this is called as a strangle, whereby the person is, you know, paying less premium than a straddle because he's in slightly out of the money call and put, but still with the same market outlook. Say for example, he bought a call at 45,100. He bought a put at 44,900 rather than buying both at the money 45,000. By this, what happens? His break even shifts a little bit. You know, but the break even will come eventually because a big, huge movement is expected on either direction. Okay. Now, there is a short strangle as well. We have seen short straddle, whereby a person sells a call and put at the money to get the maximum premium. But there are people who say that, okay, I don't want so high premium, but I want to have high premium, but that premium should remain there for some price movement up and down. Okay. The earlier diagram, which was for this short straddle, it was like it was tapering down. Yeah, the profits were tapering down. So person, they don't want that, you know, the maximum profit to be at a point. So what they did was they entered into this kind of strategy wherein profit remains stable for some time, and then with further movement the profit goes to the zero level. Okay, so this is again, you know, few people get involved into this. Now if market is expected to go anywhere, but a person individually is expecting it to fall more, so what he can do, he can buy one call and can sell two puts. It is called as a strip strategy. Okay, and if a person is expecting market to rise more than fall, he can buy two calls and buy one put. You know, this is how different combinations can be made using options with different views. Now there is something called as butterfly strategy. It's a four leg strategy whereby you use four options. Remember, we have talked about this in straddle, whereby the risk is left unlimited. Now to cap that risk, you can add two more options. That will be long condor butterfly. But normally a butterfly involves is by selling two options, okay, but of same type, either a call or a put. You sell two options at midway and buy two on either side at a lower strike and a higher strike, and sell two in midway. Now in this, the market outlook of the person is that market will be range bound. So I take the maximum premium and limit my downside as well. So it is a limited risk and limited reward strategy. It is a, you know, it is similarly like a long straddle, a short butterfly strategy,
wherein a large move is expected on either direction, but I don't want to keep my move on the upside as unlimited. So if I want to cap that unlimited zone as well on the sell, on the falling and buying side, so I can do that by making a short butterfly. Okay, now there are more strategies which could be possibly done. That would be spread strategies using options. Now that could be done. What is a spread? It is taking positions in taking two positions simultaneously in the same product, okay, but with different expiry period at the same strike level. This is called as calendar spread. Now spread is in options, we can have different kinds of spread strategies. One is a vertical spread, wherein what I do is underlying security is same, expiry month is same, I buy and sell in different strike prices simultaneously. Okay, this is called as vertical spreads. Now there are horizontal spreads or calendar spreads in which the underlying is same, expiry month is differs, but strike prices remain same. So I buy in 1 month at the same strike and I sell in the other month at the same strike. Okay, now there are other spreads which are called as diagonal spreads, wherein the underlyings remain same, I deal between different months buy and sell, and I do buy and sell at different strike prices as well. So these are called as diagonal spread. Okay, now we have seen calendar spread, say for example using call. So you sell a call plus buy a call at the same strike price, but do it in a different expiry month. Okay, now there is a combination which is called as a box spread. It is a combination of two vertical spreads which gives you an arbitrage profit if executed. Okay, now these vertical spreads, they are called as a bull calls. They are called as bull call spread, bull put spread, bear call spread, and bear put spreads. Okay, these are the spreads which are done in the same contract at different strike levels. So say for example bull spread using call, market outlook is bullish, so I want to trade in single contract with limited loss and limited risk and limited reward. So what I did is I buy a call at a lower strike price and sell a call at a higher strike price of the same contract, of the same underlying. So if market movement is there, market is bullish, so I will make money. Okay, and that money will be limited, and risk would be the total premium I will pay. Okay, or the net premium, because I am buying a call in the money and selling a call at a different higher strike price. So whatever is the net premium payout will be my maximum loss. Okay, now bull spread using put. Now in this, what happens is the outlook is bullish, but I want to make most of the profit from the premium money. So I buy a put at a lower strike in the money and sell one put I buy a put with a lower strike out of the money and I sell one put with a higher strike at the money. So what happens? Higher strike will give me more premium I sold, and I bought at a lower strike wherein I will be paying a very lesser premium. So I receive more premium, I pay lesser premium. So whatever is the net effect is the maximum profit which I will get out of this strategy. Bear spread using put. Okay, in this what happens is it is exactly same as the bull spread using put. Bear spread using call is exactly same as the bull spread using put, whereby we try to make money out of these premium. Okay, now bear spread using put is where I want to play for the bearishness. I buy a put at a higher strike, I sell a put at a lower strike, and in case market moves down, so within this contract I make a limited profit and maximum loss will be the net premium. Now combining this bull call spread and bear put spread, that means the first
on the left and the first on the right. Combining these two, whereby market outlook in one is bullish, the other is bearish. When we combine these two at the, okay, what happens? There comes an arbitrage situation whereby if a gap is available, it is a four leg strategy. If a gap is available and after considering the net premium, if there is a profit that remains irrespective of market going anywhere, it is a riskless profit situation whereby I wanted to show you an example whereby I buy a call at 44990, I sell a put at 44900, I sell a call at 45100 and buy a put at 45100. So when I buy call and I sell call, what I do is I was paying net premium 135 I paid and I received 61. But on the other side, when I sell the put, I received 65. I buy the put, I paid 142. So overall in this strategy, my net premium paid is 151 and the gap between the strike price is 200. 45,100 minus 44,900. So this 200 rupees is and minus 151, which is the net outflow. What I receive is the riskless profit of 49 rupees. This is called as a box spread. It is a net outflow in terms of the premium. But once you are able to get or block this kind of a spread, it's a arbitrage profit. You know, wherever what level the prices can go down or up, the profit remains 49 for you. This is there could be many such strategies more. You know, there is no end to options with option strategies. This is where I would like to block and stop the presentation, and we can take some questions if there are any. Over to you all. You can write the questions in the chat box and we will try to resolve them.
Vineet sir, there are a few questions. I'll just read it out for you so that you can answer it.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so the first question is, if you can repeat the exotic option point.
Yeah, exotic options, by now you would have understood. Exotic options are when we combine different calls and puts at different strike levels to make strategies. They become exotic options. Okay, now exotic options done using standardized derivative on the exchange will definitely involve standardized products, but exotic options in OTC markets have a different nomenclature. They are called as Bermuda options or look back options like this, you know, but that is in OTC. But on exchange, exotic options could be different combinations of call and put at different strike levels, wherein you either buy call, buy put, or you can buy call, sell put, you know, like this. These becomes exotic options. Yes, ma'am. Next question, please.
The next question is, what is the strike price of an option?
Strike price of an option is the series of prices which are given on which you can trade. Okay. So if you have traded on a particular strike price, the price or which you liked to trade on by giving or receiving premium, depending on what kind of position you take as a buyer or seller, the price on which you have traded becomes the strike price in an option.
And there's a last question that is there any margin payable in options?
Yes, I have mentioned in my presentation, margins are paid by the seller of the options. Buyer pays premium, seller receives premium, but since seller has received premium on day one, his obligation is kept till the expiry or till the time he exits his position. So he has to pay margin money. Seller pays margin money.
Okay, so I think we are done with the questions. So I thank you, Vineet sir, for such an amazing session and sharing such a detailed perspective. We are really privileged to have you today. Thank you everyone. We really appreciate you all being here, and we will see you next time. So I declare the webinar is over. Thank you.